said, I reached out to 10 people, 2 to 3 replied, and I got a meeting with 2 of them. So got a meeting with 2 of them, and then the one person just ghosted me. You know, they kept rescheduling the meeting and you know, eventually ghosted me. And one person I took the meeting. So now the meeting part is also done, right? And of course, as I'm saying this, you know, you might think that I'm skipping some parts or something. It's because I, you know, don't remember literally everything, which is why we have the Q&A session at the end. You can ask me anything you want. So once I got the meeting, the other part is how to, you know, how to talk, you know, in a good way and close the client over the meeting. And I'll give you a really great tip in this, which will help you a lot. All you have to do is focus on helping the person you are having a meeting with. And this sounds cliche, right? But it's very, very true. Because if you are genuinely trying to help someone, they'll ignore some of your mistakes. The first meeting which I had, the one which I was talking about, this was, I think, in March. So I had a meeting with them, and at that time, I didn't have my PC. I just had an old laptop. The webcam was broken, like it didn't used to work. And so I said, hey, can I just, keep my video off? And they were like, yeah, okay. And if you are genuinely trying to help someone, they will ignore some of your mistakes, and they'll also, you know, be supportive. On the other side, if you are trying to be salesy and, you know, using all the tricks in the world to kind of close the deal, they'll be very critical that, okay, I can't trust this person because, you know, he has his camera off and he's, you know, his accent is very different. Because of course, if you are an Indian and you are working with international clients, you will also have this question that my accent is very different than theirs. So if you are genuinely trying to help someone, they will just ignore some of your mistakes. Don't overpromise and underdeliver. That's like the worst thing to do. That you talk a big game during the meeting and then you don't deliver. So this goes back to the service thing. You have to start with a really good service. And once you have the confidence in your service, then you are just, you know, your only focus should be to help the other person. That way the sale will go through more naturally, you know. Okay. Nobody will feel that they are being tricked. Is anyone asking a question?
Okay.
I guess so.
Guys, if you're not speaking to us, please mute yourself.
Yeah, Puru, can you just deal with this muting part?
Yeah, I'm just checking that out.
Just do that.
No problem. No problem.
Manga put so.
All right, bro.
Manga. Manga. Oh, it is good. Pila da put so
me. I guess the person is muted, so I'll resume. So, I had the camera off throughout the meeting. At that time, I wasn't PM in the night or something. But because I was genuinely trying to help them and, you know, kind of understand their concerns and talk about how I can help them, they ignored all of the mistakes and I closed that deal. So at that time, I was working at $10 per hour. And a lot of people think this, right? A lot of people think that the service I just talked about, you know, content repurposing, making Instagram videos and stuff like that, is a very, low income earning skill or something like that, that the earning potential is very less. Let me tell you this thing, and most of you will be shocked by this. Gary Vee's company, like VaynerMedia, has a division called Vayner Talent. So they do this whole thing which I talked about for other clients. You know what's their rate? Their rate is $25,000 per month. You know why that is? It's not because, you know, Instagram videos and graphics and everything is very simple. It's about value-based pricing. The value of a personal brand today is just humongous. So if you help someone with that, you can make a lot of money. And at that time, I was working at $10 per hour because it was the first time, right? So I didn't want to charge a lot. So I was working at $10 per hour and I closed that deal, and it was March. And that client is, like, I'm still working with that client. It's been 8 months. And all it took me was just the genuine, you know, kind of intent to help them. And, you know, we have done over, you know, like, 2 lakh, 3 lakhs in revenue with them. So that was the one client story. And this is the other thing, right? Did someone ask a question?
Which year that was when you actually started?
This year. I started this year in March.
and you scaled so much at this such a short period of time.
I'm not able to hear you properly. Can you, you know, fix your voice or something?
So you scaled it to higher, like, so in so much short period of time that, and it's quite tricking up.
Okay.
How can you do that?
Let me explain. There's a difference between project work and retainer clients, right? And it's very simple. What is project work? Project work is this. Let's say you are a graphic designer. Someone wants to get a logo done from you. That, hey, please make a logo for my company. You make the logo, they pay you, and then you are on your own separate ways. That's known as project work. You work for a very short period of time. And then the other is retainer clients. You work for them on a monthly basis. Let's say digital marketing. You're handling their Facebook ads and charging a particular amount of money per month. That is known as retainer client. So in my case, it was retainer. It was, you know, per month, like charging, like daily, you know, sending them content for their socials and stuff. And per month, I didn't used to charge monthly at that time. I'm still not charging monthly because, like, that's a totally different thing, which I'll have to explain in detail. So I'll just ignore that for now. I used to charge hourly at that time. I'm charging hourly at this time. This time the rate is more. At that time, it was $10 per hour. And I think you were asking that how I scaled it to, you know, in a short period of time. It was just once the sale happened, I worked for them like on a monthly basis, and $10 per hour, if you, you know, sum it up over 8 months, and I don't work on this like every day. That's the benefit of freelancing, right? I work whenever I get time. It's pretty easy to, you know, get to that 2 lakh, 3 lakh mark. So that was the story of the first client. I'll wait for any of your questions so that I can move to the next one.
Could you also repeat the name of the company that was charging $25,000 a month?
Vayner Talent. It's a website. It's not a separate website. It's a division under Vayner Media. So you can go to where I'm getting a call. I'll have to mute myself. Sorry guys, I got a call. So the name of the company is Vayner Talent. You can just Google it, you will find that. And that's the company which charges $25,000 per month for that.
Which platform did you find the client?
Bring up your brand, own brand, right?
So I think Shaki is asking that which platform did I use. So as I said, I used LinkedIn. I DM'd them on LinkedIn, and then we got together on a meeting, and that's how it happened, a Zoom meeting. Any other questions?
And you are probably telling like making a brand is quite much good enough rather than going individually.
It depends upon the type of your audience, right? Now, previous year when I was working with Indian clients, it was very easy for me to leverage my brand because I have a lot of, you know, followers across India, but I don't have that internationally. So when I wanted to work with international clients, I had to go to the, you know, the sales route, not the brand route, because I didn't have any international following. So it depends, like, depends on your audience.
Okay, so what was your experience while dealing with your first foreign client?
So it was, you know, there was a lot of hesitation in the beginning, which is why I didn't charge in advance, right? If you charge in advance and you aren't able to deliver, it's like the worst thing which can happen. So I used to send them an invoice after the month so that, you know, if they have any complaints or something, they can just let me know in advance before paying. And it depends, you know, if you should work with credible clients. I mean, if you have any sort of doubts, then you can charge some in advance. But the founder of that company, unfortunately, I can't, you know, name that person because of obvious reasons. Some clients I'll be able to name, some I won't be able to. So the company which the person was running is, you know, a very big IT services company in the Washington, D.C. area. So I was kind of, you know, relaxed about the payment thing. I was like, okay, they'll pay. And I used to work like for the entire month and then send them the invoice so that you know, even if they have any complaints or something, they can let me know before paying. That way, you know, you have a lot of freedom. Even if you fuck up the entire thing, they are like, okay, you greatly under-delivered. We don't want to pay you. It's kind of, you know, better than charging a lot of money and then you aren't able to deliver and then you have to refund the money. So, yeah.
Are you working alone or you have a company? Like, anybody with you?
When I started, I used to work alone because I couldn't afford hiring people. As I expanded and, you know, like, I'm still mostly working alone, but I have, you know, 2 to 3 freelancers always, you know, on my WhatsApp whenever I'm busy and I wanted to get stuff done. And, you know, I'm also part of 2 pro leagues. So I'm in the game design pro league, I'm in the sales pro league. Sometimes it's hard to manage time, so I outsource some of the work to them. And yeah, but most of the times I just work alone, because this is the other thing which I've learned, right? If you try to expand too quickly, you are just going to fall again and again. So what used to happen was, let's say I got, you know, like at the end of the month, I got a lot of money. You hire someone, right? Now you have this unnecessary burden of hitting the payroll amount every month. So let's say you hire someone for 20,000 rupees per month. Then you are like, okay, no matter what happens, no matter how busy I am, I have to hit this mark. Otherwise, I'll not be able to pay this person. So the best thing is, of course, to outsource it to freelancers, not to full-time employees, so that you can just pay them for their time, not like for the entire month. But that too, I would say, first build a, you know, kind of a good bank balance. Then you can, you know, afford that risk, and then you can hire good people. Earlier, I was like, I can't afford, you know, a very high rates. So I used to look for people who will work, let's say, for, you know, around that. So I was charging $10 per hour at that time, right? So for me to be profitable, I used to think, how can I find people who will charge $5 per hour, 7, 8? And there are, you know, the market is full of such people. You know, you can even find people who will work for you like $4, $3 per hour, because people are crazy for work. But what happens is the quality is just shit. And so I thought, okay, I will not expand now. I'll just build a lot of bank balance. And once I have that, I'll hire good people so that, you know, I'm not tensed every minute. Like, I spent this much amount on this person. What if he doesn't deliver? If you have a good bank balance built initially, then it's very, you know, easy and painless to scale. So I'm still working alone for the most part.
How you build portfolio at that time in the beginning? Or is it necessary to create a website to show your work at the time of hiring?
Good question.
At the time.
Yeah, good question. So I still don't have a website, right? Close to 3 lakhs in revenue and I still don't have a website, because it's, I don't know, it's, if it's necessary for you, if you are, you know, doing like running Instagram ads or Facebook ads around your service and your website is your landing page, of course it's required. But in my case, the website was like, at no point, you know, did the client ask for the website or something. I used to reach out to them, Zoom meeting, and then close them. So the website was not required. I still don't have any website. Of course, you know, I've been procrastinating a lot about that. I'll get it done maybe, you know, next month or something, but it's not required. It's the lean startup methodology, right? Just focus on things which are really, really required. And then once you are, you know, making a lot of money, then you can kind of do the other extra things. The other question you asked was the portfolio one, right? So at that time, I didn't have any portfolio, but I had a lot of kind of achievements to my name. So whenever I used to kind of explain them my service, I used to tell them that I have a lot of experience in the YouTube space. You know, I have a lot of videos, over 1 million views, 40k subscribers and stuff like that. So I understand the YouTube ecosystem well. I have podcasting experience, because for people who know me, you know, since a long time, I started, you know, in one of the India's first, you know, Hindi entrepreneurship podcast or something like that. Then I moved to English. So I podcasted, like, the podcasting phase was, I think, for 1 year, you know, interviewed big guests. I interviewed Jatin Ahuja, who is the CEO of Big Boy Toys, Gautam Birani, and stuff like that. So I also understood how to reach out to people for podcast interviews and stuff like that. So I also used to tell them, like, tell the prospects this thing, that I can also help you with podcasting. And then, but the real portfolio thing was, I used to send them content pieces for free, right? So what used to happen was, the client which I got a meeting with, which I then closed, which I was talking about, they actually ghosted me for, I think, 2 to 3 days. And then what I did was, I kind of, you know, edited a piece of content for them, like for their Instagram, and sent it to them for free. And then they were like, okay, you can do it. Let's get on a meeting. So you don't necessarily have to have a big portfolio. What you can do is just, you know, create something for them for free and then send it their way. And if they like it, then of course they'll get on a meeting with you and you can then go ahead and close them.
Ronit,
any other questions?
Did you had any kind of imposter syndrome where we feel like there are many other people doing the same, but as we are doing it for the first time, we might not be able to deliver, like that kind of self-doubt of reaching out to US when we haven't?
Yeah, I get it. The imposter syndrome, right? That, hey, I'm not even from the US market. I live in India. Will I be able to understand the requirements? Will I under-deliver? And I think all of that can be solved by, you know, just charging like later. Like first do the work, send them some stuff for free. And if they like it and agree to get with you on a meeting, that means your work is good enough, right? Of course, you have to improve, but that's a good indicator that you are going on the right path. And once you kind of close the deal, of course, like I've been, you know, in this thing since 8 months, and still whenever I get a new client, there's a lot of panic. And the reason there's a lot of panic is because you don't understand them well yet. Whenever, you know, the client which I'm working for since 8 months, you know, texts me on WhatsApp that, hey, can you get this done or can you get that done? I don't even break a sweat. It's very cool. And the reason is I've been working for 8 months, so I know the entire thing. Whenever you close a new client, especially retainer clients who you will be charging monthly, there is going to be a lot of panic because you don't understand them. You are like, what if this deal falls away, like falls apart? What if that? What if this? But, you know, just stick with it. If the client agreed to get with you on a meeting and you showed them samples and they liked it, it means you are going on the right path. If possible, charge afterwards. First, do the work. And I think, you know, you'll be able to deal with it. It's not very hard. Just jump into the pool. That's the only way you figure it out.
Should we really depend upon the Upwork or a Fiverr or any other freelancing platforms as a freelancer? Should we really depend? Or should we purchase that proposals before getting any clients?
So I'll tell you this, right? You are just a commodity on Fiverr and Upwork. And a commodity, this is what a commodity means, right? Let's say I'm, forget for a moment that I'm a freelancer. Let's say I'm a prospect, you know, I'm a client. I'm looking for someone on Upwork who can build me a website. I'm just giving an example. Don't reach out to me that, hey, you said you wanted a website. So let's say I go on Upwork and I want to find someone who can build a website for me. There are thousands of people out there, right? If someone is doing it for $10 an hour, someone is also ready to do it for $7. Someone is also ready to do it for $5. Or, I mean, I don't know the exact numbers, but it's just the competition is so much that you have very, very less leverage, right? There is no differentiation. It's like just a lot of freelancers under one roof, and you can pick whichever one fits your budget, fits your requirements, fits everything. So you have very less leverage on platforms. If you are the top rated seller and you've been working for 4 or 5 years and, you know, your ranking is very good, then there's that. That's a whole different thing. But if you're a newcomer, you have very less leverage on platforms. And I think they take like 20% cut or something, right? So that's just monstrous. I mean, it's better to learn B2B sales yourself, reach out to people and kind of, you know, just do the entire thing yourself. Just treat it like a business, right? If you're a freelancer, it doesn't mean you have to be on these platforms. And because these platforms and have unlimited number of freelancers, they will always kind of, you know, try to put you down. Recently, my friend Ayush Shukla, who is, you know, working on, I think, Fiverr or Upwork, I think it was Upwork, he kind of closed a client and he just did a small mistake, like not even a big mistake, like a small mistake, something, I don't know the details, and Upwork straight away suspended him, like suspended his account, right? So it's like months of hard work got wasted. So on platforms, you don't have any leverage. If you learn B2B sales, and it's not very hard, right? If you can't afford, you don't have to get into the sales pro league. Just, you know, learn basic stuff from Google and YouTube and kind of break it down, right? What is B2B selling? First thing is reaching out to people. So you have to learn the art of cold emails and cold reach out. It's very simple. I think if you sit for an entire day, you can get most of the information, and then it's about experience. What's the other part? The other part is getting on a meeting with them. You can learn that in a day, and then it's about experience. And then the third part is just closing the deal over the meeting, right? And you also have to understand this. You will not be closing everyone. Like, for the few clients I'm working with, you know, a lot of like 10, 20, 30, 40, I don't know how many deals have fallen apart. It's because sales is like dating, right? It's not that you will be able to close every single prospect you come across. If the prospect has a need and you are able to fulfill that need, then it's just about the pricing. And if they also agree on the pricing, then the deal closes. So there are just two or three parts of, you know, B2B selling. Just reach out, meeting, and then closing, you know, just communicating your value and stuff like that. So if you know these things, if you know how to prospect people and stuff like that, it's like very easy. Why do you need to depend on platforms? And for the people who are confused that, you know, oh, I don't want to miss out on the immense exposure on platforms, do both. Do, you know, platforms also do like B2B sales, and just, you know, go ahead with what works best. For me, I, you know, it's been like 8 months, like almost it's the end of the year, and I haven't, you know, really felt any need to depend on platforms and pay them 20%.
Hey, Ronit, a bird question, man. So what do you do at times when you feel like you're not able to deliver, like, you know, you don't feel like working and you miss out on some work and there's work pending and there's this immense tension of how you're going to get it done and all of that?
So saying no is also an important part, right? Because, you know, when you get into freelancing, there's this initial struggle phase, let's say 5 months, 6 months, when you get no clients. And so a point comes where you are, let's say, getting a lot of clients. It's really hard to say no to work because you have been through that phase of the struggle of not getting clients. And once you start getting clients, you are like, okay, I will work with all of them. I don't want to say no to a single person. Well, that's not really possible because you only have so many hours a day. I mean, you can outsource, but again, it sounds simple that, okay, I'll outsource this. Hiring is very hard. Finding good people who will be able to, you know, understand what it takes to deliver good, you know, whatever it is that you do, designs or videos or stuff, it's very hard. It just sounds simple that if I get more work, I'll just outsource it. It doesn't work like that. So sometimes you just have to say no. And I think there is a website for this. Wait, let me just check. And I'll also drop it in the freelancing channel. Okay, there it is. Copy link. Avalon.
Actually, what I was trying to say, see, exactly what I do is, I mean, it's kind of like what you do, I guess, you know, to turn podcasts into micro content for Instagram and LinkedIn on all of those platforms. So finding people to really judge the work, you know, to find out the important part. That's the main part, which people can do. Editing is the easy part. To find out the important sections of the video, that's the main part. And not everybody can do that. And Lord, what happens a lot of time is that with consistent content being produced by the host, I'm not able to sometimes keep up with the work and it gets into pending. A lot of works get pending and sometimes I feel like giving up, but then I do it. And like, you know, for the past 3-4 months I've been doing it and then I stopped for the past 1 month. I've been passively doing it. I mean, very slowly with design and all, not that podcasting. So the only reason I stopped for this past 1 month was because I wasn't able to keep up, and that's the most important thing that I'm having to deal with, and I'm not able to figure out the solution to that.
So whenever you feel like this, like you can't outsource and you also can't do the entire stuff yourself, break the service down into a few parts, right? So let's say if you are dealing with micro content, there are four parts of micro content, right? Video, image, audio, and text. It's very hard to do. It's very hard for you to do all four. So just pick one and start with that. Let's say you just pick video. You are like, I'll only create Instagram videos for clients. So go ahead with that. Build your bank balance. Who's playing some good music? Please stop. Puru, can you mute this person?
Yeah, wait. Okay. Muting.
Okay, so whenever you don't have time, just break that service down into like 2-3 parts, and once you are done with that, pick one, go ahead with that, build your bank balance, then find one good person who can, you know, deal with some stuff and work with him on long term. Varun also, you know, like just now uploaded a story on his Instagram that small teams over big teams. Just find one person who can maybe, you know, do 2-3 things instead of, you know, hiring 3 people for 3 different things. So break that service down, go with one thing, build the bank balance, and then, you know, you can kind of hire good people. So I mean, it's different for different niches, but because you asked the question about micro content, so that will be my input on that.
Okay. How do you negotiate properly when you have they are saying like there are people who can do the same stuff at the minimal rate from you? So how do you manage those kind of guys?
So here's the thing, right? It will be very beneficial for you if you pick a very niche service. If you are very broad, it's known as being very vanilla, right? What vanilla means is being very generic. You are like, okay, I do video editing. It will be very hard for you to negotiate. So you have to find a differentiator, like, which is a differentiating factor, which kind of separates you from other people. So if you see the competition in video editing, it's insane. If you see the competition in what I just talked about, it's very less. So find a niche, you know, in which you work with. It will be easier for you to work with good clients, because if you are very vanilla, if you are like, hey, I'm a video editor, I want to work with you, they can get a video editor for $5 an hour. That's not the way you kind of work with big clients. And the other thing is, we only reach out to people who you think, you know, will not have a problem, you know, kind of bargaining with you on $5 or $7. So the person I first reached out to was, as I said, running a big IT services company. So I thought, okay, I don't think there will be any problem. And when they asked me how much I will charge, I'll charge $10 per hour, and they're like, cool. Because, and mostly this is another thing, right? If you're working with international clients, $10 per hour or $15 per hour for them is very, very cheap. In India, it's more, you know, if you ask Indian clients to pay you 1,000 rupees per hour, it's kind of, if you are, you know, very great in your field, that can be possible. But for newcomers, it's very hard. Indian clients don't pay that much. So two things on that. If you want to negotiate, first, pick a niche service so that you have some differentiating factor. If you are, let's say, a graphic design, if you're, let's say, a web designer, right? I think there's a channel called Flux. That guy uploaded a video on this, and he said he only works with startups in this space, and he only does web design for those people, or something like that. You can go check that video out. So it's very important to pick a niche so that you are different from others. You don't have to be vanilla. If you are vanilla, if you are just like everyone, of course negotiation will be hard for you. But if you are different, if it's difficult to find you, it's very easy to negotiate. Most of the times, you know, if you are working with good clients, they will just say yes, you know, we are cool with that rate.
For the freelancing work you do, what skills are required?
Sorry, I'm not able to hear you properly. Can you just leave it in the text channel, your question?
Okay. I'm asking skills required.
Okay, skills. So you can pick any skill. You know, if you have read Pajama Prophet, there is a chart of the skills which you can pick. But once you kind of identify your skill, let's say you... Okay, wait a minute. Sorry, I got a call. So once you identify the skill which you want to go in, go niche, right? If let's say you pick motion graphics, don't be like, hey, I'm a, you know, person who does motion graphics. Go kind of, you know, very niche. I only work with this set of people. Because if you repel some audience, let's say someone comes across you and reads that you only work with a certain kind of people, you might think, well, that's repelling some people. Some people might come and just go back because they are like, this person only works with this type of people. But by the sheer fact that you are repelling some people, you are also attracting some people, right? So this is kind of a marketing topic. I'll not go into the details, but you asked which skills are required to get into freelancing. Read Pajama Prophet. It will explain most of your questions. Once you have your skills sorted, go niche. That will be my advice.
What are the skills that you use?
So, as I said, I use the skill of content repurposing. I've been in that, you know, for like 2-3 years. I've also worked with Digital Pratik for like 3 months. You might be knowing him. So, you know, I already had experience in that. So it was not very hard for me to kind of grow with that. So, yeah, that was the skill or the freelance niche which I started with.
How do you build trust in the first place when you, while you prospecting, you send the message to other person? How could he trust you? What could you do? What do you do for that?
Make something for them for free and send it. That's the way you build trust. Then they'll be like, okay, now I'm sure that this person can handle this sort of work, right? Once that is done, it's very easy. You know, then it's just about kind of rates and everything, like how much you'll charge and stuff. But that's only when your prospecting was done right. And as I said, if you had a proper ideal client persona in your mind and then you prospected well, only then it will work. Otherwise, if your prospecting was shit, then of course your reply rates are going to be shit because you reached out to the wrong people. So building trust, just, you know, make something for them for free to prove your skills, or if you already have a portfolio, send them that. And once you're on the Zoom meeting, try to be genuinely helpful. You know, you don't have to use any tricks. You don't have to use any fancy sales lines. Try to be genuinely helpful. It will go through naturally. Just trust me on this. Can you go one by one?
Is holiday season good for finding new clients?
What did you ask? What is good for finding new clients?
Is holiday season good, like the month of December,
holiday
for
season,
finding new clients?
So, if you are reaching out to influential people, they are just totally, you know, kind of switched off during the holiday season. It's because I have worked with some influential people. So, I would not really say that holiday season is good. I mean, you can try, but, you know, during holiday season, even the clients which I'm working with, like the deal is closed, they are paying me every month. Even they don't reply. They have, you know, their WhatsApp off, they have their emails off, and they get back after, you know, for example, during the Thanksgiving period, I wasn't getting replies. I got the reply after, you know, the Thanksgiving weekend was over. So you can try. I mean, if there's a strategy around it, which you came across on Google or YouTube, maybe you can go, you know, try that. But I wouldn't really recommend it because during holiday season, people aren't even, you know, discussing with their inner team members. They are like chilled out and stuff. So when they are in their work hours, maybe that will be better.
Let's say I'm a graphic designer. Or should I really depend upon the one category, like logo designing or a template or you can say newsletter, brochure? Should we really depend upon the one or all week I can focus upon?
I'm not really into graphic designing, so I don't think, you know, I have a really good answer for that, but I have this answer for that, you know, like this particular answer. Just pick a service which you are immensely confident with. You are like, okay, once I close this client, he's going to be amazed with the work I do. And let's say if, you know, you can't do the entire, you know, set of graphic designing, maybe let's say you just know how to design posters and you don't know the other things, then just go with posters, right? Because the most important sale, and remember this, I mean, you can note down if you want to, the most important sale is selling yourself to your own service. Because if you aren't sold enough to your own service, you won't have that confidence when you are in the meeting. You'll always have this in the back of your mind that, hey, what if I'm not, you know, able to deliver? So once you are sold to your own service, it gets very easy. You will be immensely confident, you know, in your kind of meetings. So that will be my answer. I know it's not a very, you know, great kind of answer because I'm not into graphic designing a lot. Maybe you can put that in the design channel. But yeah, that will be my input on that.
Which software did you use?
Yeah, so first I'll answer the software question. I think some other person was also asking a question. Just wait a few minutes. So softwares for video, I use Premiere Pro for design, or like, you know, for some Instagram and stuff, I use Photoshop. Then there's a software called Weed.io, not that Weed, it's Weed.io, which is kind of, you know, a web software. It's very niche, you know, I mean, you can go check it out, Weed.io. That is the other software you use for, you know, automating a lot of the stuff which micro content involves. And then, yeah, that's, I mean, I think that's pretty much it. I'm not able to hear you properly. Whoever asked the question, can you just drop it in the text channel?
You convince your parents.
How did I convince my parents? So, I mean, that will be a very detailed answer. I mean, you don't have to explain them everything, right? Let's say you are doing college, right? Like on the side of college, they don't really care if you're playing games or if you're doing freelancing, right? I mean, you don't have to go all in on freelancing. You don't have to drop out to do freelance, or you don't have to leave everything else to do freelancing. You can work 4 to 5 hours per day. And once, you know, once you get the first payment, they'll be all in on this. You know, once you show them that, hey, I received this much of money, especially if you work with international clients, the sum is going to be just awesome. You know, the money which I was making during lockdown when all businesses were shut, you know, like people who were doing jobs were getting half salary. It was just crazy. So my parents were like, okay, just go do it. But the first, when you are just getting started, you don't have to explain them everything. Just do it on the side, you know, just like you scroll Instagram on the side, just try to do some freelance stuff. Once you get the money, show them that it's just for Indian parents. If you show them the money, they'll be all in on that. They'll actually support you to do it. So that's kind of, you know, my answer on that.
Which medium you used to get paid, like PayPal or any Payoneer?
I used PayPal, and this is the thing, right? You give, I gave the client the option that do you want to pay through PayPal, but if you want to pay, you have to cover the fees, because of course PayPal is just brutal with the fees and, you know, the other charges they do.
Yeah.
So you have to cover the fees, or you can wire transfer me the amount. And what happens is clients are usually, you know, very comfortable with PayPal. PayPal is just what, 2-3 clicks and the payment is done. So they are like, okay, you know, we'll do it through PayPal and we'll cover the fees. So that's kind of, you know, very simple. You give the client the option, right, that it will be great if you can wire transfer the amount. And for wire transfer, I think TransferWise is great. I've been using PayPal till now because clients were like, okay, we'll cover the fees, but we want to use PayPal for its simplicity and stuff. So you can just give them the option, right? As I said, PayPal or wire transfer. Trifles.
You have deal with them.
What do you say? Can you just repeat your question?
Some clients also rely with Stripe. So have you dealt with them? Like, they have only Stripe medium.
Stripe is used to charge people, right? Like, not pay people. I mean, I don't really know about that. I mean, I can use Stripe to charge the clients, but
yeah,
I don't think if they can pay through Stripe or what. So I'll tell you why I don't use Stripe. I actually for a while tried the model of charging monthly, right? And monthly, I think I came up with the price of $2,000 per month. But the reason it wasn't working, like I tried it for a brief period of time, the reason it wasn't working is because it's very, you know, very in the context of my service. It can be different for your service. So in my service, what happens is I'm usually dealing with busy people, right? As I said, who don't have time for content and want me to support them. They are very busy, like they are running companies and stuff. So because they are very busy, for 1 week, they sometimes go totally inactive. They are like, hey, I will not be able to, you know, do this social media stuff. So that's why I was not able to charge monthly, because let's say I work for 2 weeks and I have that, you know, automated Stripe thing. So Stripe basically allows you to charge people automatically. Let's say I already, you know, set Stripe to charge this particular person $2,000 per month, but for 1 or 2 weeks they were inactive, then that's wrong, right? I worked only for 1 or 2 weeks and you still, they got debited for $2,000. And yeah, that's why I don't use Stripe. That's why I use the hourly billing method, because when you are dealing with busy people, like if you're working for a month, 1 week, they're just going to be immensely busy and you will not be able to work. So hourly is, you know, very kind of good effort reward based kind of system. And it has been working perfectly for me till now. That's why I don't use Stripe. I just send them an invoice. And if you are using PayPal, don't send invoices through the mobile app. The PayPal invoice system in the web app of PayPal, like when you open it in desktop, is much more advanced. You can, you know, there are different templates for invoices. There is monthly, there is hourly, there is quantity based, there is quality based, or something like that, 3 to 4 templates. So do it through that. It's amazing. And if you have, you know, GST registered for yourself, then you don't have to make the invoice separately, because PayPal automatically kind of gives you a PDF invoice or something which you can, you know, use to file returns and stuff.
How do I start getting clients?
Yeah, I have GST registered, but I did that after like several months, right? So I think I did that in September. It was because I needed the current account for it, because I like keeping, you know, personal and business expenses, like personal and business stuff separate. And if you get a lot of foreign payments in your savings account, I mean, huge volumes, sometimes they can be flagged, right? Because foreign payments are, you know, a lot of times used for money laundering. And also I had my account in SBI, and it is not really, you know, great with kind of international software. Whenever I used to purchase an international software to automate some of my work, SBI cards just don't used to work. So I got a current account opened in ICICI, and for that I needed GST. So I also got that done.
One second. Samrat is asking a question in a freelancing group. He's asking that I am a full stack developer. How to find out people, even on LinkedIn, to offer my services and portfolio? How to find people looking out for your particular niche? And adding it on my own, I would ask that ki is the kitna competition hai, matlab, coding mein, if you do freelancing?
I'm not a coder. I'm not a full stack developer. So I don't really know how that, you know, niche works. But if, as I said, if before you start prospecting, you have to create an ideal client persona. And if your ideal client persona is being able, you know, is fulfilled through LinkedIn Sales Navigator or the filters which are there in LinkedIn Sales Navigator, then you can just use that. But I, as I said, it's different for different services. So I don't know much about coding. So I don't think I'll be able to answer that question, but LinkedIn Sales Navigator is perfect for most services. You should at least try it for a month. And, you know, Varun has, I think, a free sales course on the Meta app. Do that. He also has that video on creating ideal client persona and importing it in LinkedIn Sales Navigator. So that should help. This is a good question. Wait a minute. Yesh Vaswani is asking, how do you calculate your working hours for client? Great question. So you can either use Clockify. You can just go to Google on and search Clockify. It will track your work and it will track the hours you are working. But I don't use that, because when I'm working, like, I don't, you know, like some software just you know, recording everything, because sometimes, you know, I just go downstairs for some work, or sometimes I get a call and I'm working. And it's, instead of that, I use timesheets. Like, you can either use a software which tracks, you know, kind of your time. It takes a screenshot every 10 minutes or something like that. You can check out Clockify for that. But a better one would be timesheets. So what are timesheets? I think I'll send you, I don't have it. Sorry. You can just go to Google and type free timesheet templates for freelancing. What, like, you will get a PDF kind of thing. And in that you can insert the hours, right? Like on Monday, let's say today's Monday, right? Yeah, Monday, 14 December, I worked from 5 p.m. to 9 p.m. on this particular thing. And then the next day you know, insert the next day's work. So every day you kind of just, you know, fill that timesheet. And at the end of the month, you can send them that. So that, you know, most of the clients are happy with just timesheets. They don't want, you know, a proper, like, time track thing, screenshot every 10 minutes or something like that. So you can use that. Sneha is saying you can also use Time Tracker. Of course, time tracking softwares are great, but I don't like it. I mean, it's just a personal thing. You can use time tracking softwares as well. Or you can just use timesheets, where you can just, you know, fill in the data every single day and then send the final PDF at the end of the month along with the invoice.
Does your client says that Google X or
Facebook? What kind of content they want for the?
So someone was asking, have I tried Google Ads? No, I haven't tried that. And House of M is asking, have you tried calling for clients in UK, USA and Canada? I haven't done calls, because, you know, it's mostly email and then Zoom meeting. It's not a cold call, but I will give you a tip on how to find people's phone numbers, right? If you want to do cold calls. So, I mean, it can be, again, a niche answer. It can be different for your niche, but I figured out that most of the people who have small Instagram profiles but public ones forget to remove their number from their Instagram profiles. I mean, I have an Excel sheet of kind of like 15 to 20 prospects which I have in case of emergency. Let's say, you know, all my clients, you know, go away, leave me, I will hit that list, and I have all of their numbers, and you'll be surprised that I found every single number through their Instagram profile. They had like 300, 400 followers, and usually small profiles, what they do is they forget to take out their number. So you can use that. I mean, you know, if let's say you find a prospect on LinkedIn, go to their Instagram profile. If they have a small profile and if it's also public, then you hit the, you know, kind of the lucky thing. You'll be able to find their number through that. Or you can just go to LinkedIn contact info. Sometimes they even leave their number there. And if it's not there, you can just use the email to Zoom call route. So H412 is asking. Yeah, sure. You can go ahead with your question. I'll answer that later.
What do you do when, while building trust, the material you are sending, the work you are sending is can be copied by the other person. So what do you do in case like that?
What do you mean by copied by the person? I send it to them through email, right? So it's just the two parties are involved, me and the prospect. Like, I mean, how can someone copy it? I don't think I'm able to get your question properly.
Like, he could get it done from the other person for much cheaper price, like websites.
As I said, it's all about differentiation. If you are just one, if you have a very broad category that I do video editing, I do coding, it will be very hard for you to deal with that question which you just asked. But if you have a very niche service, if you are different from others, and there are a lot of ways to differentiate yourself, right? I'll actually leave a link to the differentiation factors which you can use.
Hey, there is a very important question. Like, does they talk about the taxes? Means the payment they do, they cut the US taxes or anything? It's upon you.
Just a minute, wait. So guys, whichever links I'm dropping them in the freelance channel, not the main channel. So be sure to check out the freelance channel afterwards. So there you go with the differentiation strategy. You can check this out. So the about the taxes, right? So if you are registered under GST, there's a good news that international payments or service exports are exempt from GST. It's basically nil. But the purchases which you make in India, let's say you purchase a software, or let's say you kind of do any purchase in India, that you can file for return. But the sales which you make, to international people, it's exempt from GST. It's basically nil. So that's about it. You don't have to charge GST to international people because it's exempt from that. And regarding, you know, the foreign taxes or whatever, which they might be charging, I don't think that is the case, because again, when it's international, it's just the taxes are not applicable. Let's say I'm in India and I'm selling something to the US person, the Indian tax is not applicable. And if he's purchasing the service from me from India, that tax might also be not applicable. I'm not really sure, but till date, you know, there is no such taxes thing involved.
Do you have any idea of starting a company?
Starting a company. So here's the thing, right? You can either start a service-based company or you can start a product-based company. Service-based company doesn't require a lot of capital. You can just easily start it. Just learn a skill, start freelancing, and then hire people under you. And then you can just scale it into a service-based agency. Something like Avalon Labs, right? Then you kind of, you know, make a lot of money, you build the bank balance, and then you can move into product-based, because product-based, of course, requires a lot of investment upfront. Of course, it's easier to scale. It's really hard to scale a services company, but that's kind of the way I think a lot of people go in their capitalism journey. You know, they start with either a job or freelancing or a service-based business, because it takes in a less amount to start. And then once they have that bank balance, they invest it into kind of going the product-based route.
Is there a good demand for a freelancer who knows to run Google Ads?
Of course, there's a good demand, but again, you have to differentiate yourself. If you are just like everyone, hey, I also do Google Ads, there are like a million other people who are ready to do Google Ads. So it's up to you how you differentiate yourself. For me, actually, I forgot to talk about one part. Previous year, like in 2019, when I had no idea about freelancing, I, you know, started learning design, and I was, you know, working with in Indian clients. At that time, I didn't even think it was possible to work with international clients until I saw Varun's video on Instagram where he was talking about how he used to work with international clients. So I thought, okay, I can also do it. But previous year, I was working with Indian clients and I had no differentiation, right? I had some differentiation, which is why I was able to get, you know, a few clients. And the only differentiation was brand. Like I, you know, had a good YouTube audience, good podcast audience. And so it was, that was the differentiation factor, right? I was different from other, you know, designers and something. So you have to find something which makes you different. If you are just like everyone, it will be very hard for you to get clients. And even if you get clients, it will be very hard for you to negotiate. So either, you know, go very niche or use some other differentiating strategy. I sent the link in the freelance channel. Be sure to check it out.
Hey, Ronit. Ronit, I want to ask you, like, you talked about creating the persona of the client. What are the main things you should consider as a designer or anything? Like how? What was the process for you creating the persona and what were the factors you considered for international?
Creating a persona is very simple, right? I mean, it's not a fancy thing. For me, it was like half the size of a paper. I took out a notebook and a pen. Of course, I used that website, which I've said, but that was later on. And I wrote down which is the kind of person I'm targeting. And I wrote down like 4 to 5 points. Okay. So the first point was the person wants to put out content on social media, but doesn't have time for it because he's running a company. Because people who, it's generally business people who don't have time to, you know, do all this stuff. Otherwise, if you look at just normal content creators who do content for a living, they have all the time in the world. So that was the first point. Second point was the person should be based in the US. Third point was the person should be credible enough, you know, and you can judge credibility based on their profiles, right? If you just look at their LinkedIn and if you look at how their company is doing, it's very easy to judge their credibility. And kind of those were the 3 to 4 points. So that's the persona, right? If you are a programmer and you are, you know, trying to pitch prospects, you have to first put down a persona. Once you have the persona ready, it's very easy to get, you know, started with prospecting. And there are a lot of questions in the freelancing tips, but I'm kind of not able to keep up with all. So just go a bit slow with that. I'll pick this question by Akash. He says, how making micro content for clients help them to generate more sales? It's a very long-term approach, Akash. It's not that today you put out video on Instagram and tomorrow you have a lot of sales. It's a very, very long-term process. After 3 to 4 years, you are able to, you know, reach to a point of brand where you get a lot of money. Like if you look at Gary Vee, when he started, very less people knew him. After 4 to 5 years in this content game, he charges $100,000 per hour for a stage speech. So it's a very long-term process. That's what you have to explain to the clients. And again, House of M is asking, was the client Pep Laya was because of your brand, because he gets a lot of emails as CXL is a brand? No, that was not because of the brand. And I've answered a lot of questions. So let me move into the next thing. I talked about, you know, the story of the first client. Now I'll talk about the story of this client, Pep Laya, right? So when I got my, you know, firm registered, like sole proprietorship firm in September, I was like, okay, now I'll pitch, you know, more clients. And services are actually boring sometimes. So you have to do something. Like freelancing, it seems interesting. It gets boring real quickly. So you have to find something which makes you passionate about it. And for me, that was, I wanted to work with big people, like, you know, screw normal people. I mean, nothing against them, but I wanted to work with influential people, like, you know, verified accounts across, you know, like big founders and stuff like that. But in October, I had a lot of, you know, college exams, assignments, same with November. So I wasn't able to do it. But in like the second half of November or December, I thought, okay, now I'm ready. I'm done with the assignments. I'm done with the exams. Let's go. So this story of Pep Laya, there was a bit of luck involved in this, right? You know, there's this quote that when opportunity meets preparation or something like that. So Pep tweeted on his Twitter profile that he was looking for someone who can repurpose his content for different forms, you know, for social media, because he didn't have a lot of time for it. And I am the person who is doing this since March, right? And my good friend Chatty Sharma, official Chatty on Instagram and Twitter, he replied on that tweet. Actually, I wasn't following him on Twitter. Like, I wasn't following Pep on Twitter. I was following him on LinkedIn. So I wasn't able to, you know, read that tweet. So he replied on that tweet. He tagged me that Ronit Magnani is the person you should be talking to or something like that. And referrals were great, right? I'll tell you an like an unethical way to get clients. It's up to you. You want to use it or not. If you if you have done the meta sales course, like the free sales course on the app, you know about social listening, right? So what is social listening? Social listening is searching for keywords on Twitter or LinkedIn so that you can find people who are, you know, looking for a person like that. That's social listening. I'll not go into the details again because it will take like 10 to 15 minutes. You can just go through the meta sales course, the free one. So if you do social listening and you come across someone who is looking for your service, instead of you replying to him that, hey, I can do it, get your friend, you know, like ask your friend, one of your friends who has a Twitter account or basically anyone to reply on that tweet and tag you saying this is the person you should be talking to. That has more weight. Trust me on this. I didn't do it in this Pep's case, you know, I didn't ask Chatty that, hey, can you just do it? But he did it. And then I realized the potential of this trick, which I just said. It's a bit unethical. I mean, you know, you are just tricking the client. But if you have a good service, then I think you can go with that. So Chatty replied on that tweet of Pep that Ronit Magnani is the person you should be talking to. And then here is the thing with busy people, right? Like these 4 to 5 days were like immensely troubling for me after he replied on that tweet. So immediately I DM'd Pep on Twitter that, hey, you know, I just used that template, Abhinav Arora's cold email template. I use that basically every time. So I replied that, hey, you know, I can do this. And I don't remember the exact tweet, but I used that template. And he didn't reply, even though he liked that tweet. And, you know, I also replied that, hey, I just reached out to you via DM, be sure to check or something like that. He also liked that tweet, but he didn't reply for like 24 hours. Then I messaged him on Instagram because he has just 400 or 500 followers on Instagram. So I DM'd him and he still didn't reply. And at this point I was like, man, what is happening? Why did he find someone else or what? And then I emailed him and finally he replied. So in case of busy people, you just never know what can happen. If they are not replying to you, it does not necessarily mean that, you know, they don't want to do business with you, or they are just, you know, they don't like you or something like that. It's just that they are very, very busy. So I emailed Pep like after 24 hours of not getting a reply on Instagram. I emailed him and then I got the reply, I think the next day, that, hey, you know, I have this requirement. So Butcher is asking, who is Pep? Search Pep on LinkedIn. Okay. So he replied that, hey, I have a virtual event on, you know, 18th November or something like that. Can you do, can you repurpose the content and something like that? So I was like, yeah. And I shared the samples, right? As I said, I was working with one Washington DC based client since March. So I shared a lot of samples. At this point, I had a big portfolio, right? So I shared a lot of samples. He was kind of, you know, very impressed by that. And then it was very easy to close him, you know. We actually had no Zoom meeting. This is the other thing about busy people. If you are reaching out to influential people, expect to not do a Zoom meeting and just stick to email, right? Because they are like, whatever can be done through email, they will do through email. They will not go the Zoom meeting route because they just don't have the time. So we did the entire thing through email, you know. Even the questions which I wanted to ask, he didn't agree to give me his WhatsApp number. He was like, I'll stick to email. I'm very busy. I don't want a lot of messages. So kind of coordinated the entire thing through email. I think I uploaded an Instagram story, and if you saw, there were like 20 or 30 emails within a span of, you know, just 2 to 3 days. But got that done from him, you know. He paid, and finally, you know, once you actually do a small thing for them, you know, if you work for them for a client for 1 month and you do a good job, then it's very easy to retain that client. Of course, it depends on your service, whether it's a project based or retainer. But that was the story of Pep. He tweeted that he wanted a person like me. My friend replied on that. I didn't know that he was going to reply, but he replied that this is the person you should be talking to. I DM'd him on Twitter, no reply. DM'd him on Instagram, no reply. DM'd him on email, I got the reply. And this is the other thing, right? After he paid me, there was a certain part, you know, of content which was remaining. And I had some questions about it, which is why I didn't send it to him. I was like, hey, I have these 3 questions about this you know, part of the content. Can you just, you know, leave me your inputs? And he didn't reply. And I used to follow up every 3 to 4 days, and he was still not replying. I was like, okay, I think I have done a pretty pathetic job. He paid me because I worked, but I think it's just over, right? I under-delivered. But that was not the case. He was so busy that he didn't even reply to those emails, even if he saw it. And the way I figured out that he was not, you know, kind of angry with me or something like that, is he referred me to some of the amazing friends he has. And this is the power of working with influential people, right? They have a great network. If you can just win one influential person over, just one, right? Just one influential person over with your work as a business or an individual, that one great contact leads to so many great contacts. You know, he referred me to basically all of his friends. A product which is User Leap, you can go on Google and search. It's User, U-S-E-R, Leap, L-E-A-P. So that product was the number one product of the day on Product Hunt. And their team reached out to me that, hey, we need help with this. Can you do it? I'm like, sure, of course I can do it. And if you go on User Leap's Product Hunt page, you know, there is this something motion graphic they have on their Product Hunt page, which shows how the software works or something like that. That was created by me. And you know, User Leap was such a big company. I was very hesitant to work with them because they raised $16 million in Series A funding. If you go on Google and search User Leap and go on the news section, you will, you know, maybe find an article of that or what. So whenever you're working with influential people, give your best, do your best work, because you can basically live off of the amount of referrals they are going to give you, right? And then he also referred me to another person, which of course, again, I can't take the name, but that, you know, prospect or client or whatever is running a multinational B2B sales company. I think they've also consulted Gaurav Munjal, who is the CEO of Unacademy or something like that. Basically, they work with Asian founders. So he also referred me to that. You know, I've had 2 Zoom meetings with them. We haven't really started the work yet, but the referrals were amazing. So whenever you're working with influential people, just do your best work, because there are going to be a lot of referrals afterwards. And when you are working with busy people, if they ghost you, it doesn't mean they've actually ghosted you. It's just because they are incredibly busy. In fact, I had a meeting with Pep, you know, 2 to 3 days before, and he said me the same thing, that at times I'm so busy that I'm not able to, you know, reply to important emails. So don't feel discouraged. Just keep that in mind. And that meeting with Pep was actually the thing which made this voice session, which I'm doing on Discord, possible. I reached out to Abhinav Arora. He actually introduced me to Pep on one of his Instagram live streams. I was like, thank you so much. You know, I worked with Pep. Initially, I didn't know him, but you talked about him in one of your IG live streams, and now I'm working with him. Thank you so much. And then he was like, you should speak about this on our Discord channel, which is why this Discord session is happening. So now I'll pick some questions from the Freelancing Tips channel. Just stay on mute for a while. I'll, you know, answer some questions, and then some of you guys on the voice channel can hop on and ask me the question. Just wait a minute. So Sahil is asking right now how much you charge per hour. So it ranges between, you know, about like $20 per hour. Sometimes it's 15, sometimes it's 20. The reason I'm not able to go higher is because I don't have, you know, the entire month available on my side. Sometimes there's college work, sometimes I have the work of pro leagues, and that, you know, less time commitment makes me stick to $15 to $20 per hour. And again, I'll give you a great tip on pricing. So if you are confused that which hourly rate you should pick, I think you can start with $10 or $15 per hour. It's, you know, kind of like the base rate for people who are living in America. I think there was a reform to set $15 per hour as the minimum wage. Like, even waiters in hotels get like $15 per hour. So don't be afraid to, you know, charge like $10 or $15 per hour should be perfect to get started with. And if one client agrees to you like on $10 per hour or $15 per hour, the next time you should charge more. And you might say, hey, this is wrong. For one client, I'm charging them $10, and the other client, I'm charging $15. The third client, which I got, I'm charging them $20 per hour. It's very bad. It's not bad. Initially, I also used to think that it's bad, but I had a chat with Sankalp. You know, I'm in the Sales Pro League, so Sankalp is leading that. So Sankalp said that you should charge the same amount only if those two prospects or those two clients have an active communication going on. Let's say Pep referred me to one of his friends on, you know, like through email or LinkedIn or whatever, then I should charge them the same because they have been referred to me by Pep. So it would be very bad if I charge Pep less and charge the other client more. But if two prospects are like completely different, they don't even know each other and they have no active communication going on, you should charge different. Once, you know, someone agrees for $10 per hour, next time make it 15. And then the next time make it 20. And then once you start getting a lot of no's, like let's say when you're trying to go from 20 to 25 and everyone is basically saying no, stay on 20 for a while, increase your portfolio, increase, you know, your brand awareness, maybe start a podcast, maybe start a website and build a big portfolio and, you know, say that I work with these clients, then it can, you know, allow you to kind of amp up your hourly rate. But that was basically the pricing thing. Just come up with something $10-$15 per hour to start with and then keep increasing it. Of course, if you feel comfortable, don't think that it's bad to charge different prices to different people. It's not. So I'll pick another question. Ronak Magnani, how do you do work when you don't feel like to do? Means how do you be productive? Where can we see some of your works? So I actually, you know, can't share the content pieces with you because the clients don't want anyone else to have access to them because I have them hosted on, like uploaded on Dropbox, right? So if I share the link, you can actually download everything. I mean, I'm cool with that. The clients are not cool with that. So they don't want that to happen, and which is why I can do that. But the other question which you asked was like, how do you be productive? I think you have to, as I said, you have to find something which makes you be passionate about freelancing. For me, I just like to work with, you know, big people like founders, CEOs. I don't want to work with, you know, just normal clients. Of course, initially money can be a motivator that if I do this, I'm going to get paid this much. That can be a motivator, but once you start making money, once it, you know, becomes kind of habitual, you will struggle with being productive because you're like, are you boring? So in that case, you have to find something which, you know, makes you be passionate about services again, because services are boring. It's just a fact. You have to find something which, you know, makes you like them. It can be money, but sometimes you can, you know, just get bored with money. You will be like, theek hai, paisa hai, but I don't like doing this. So in that case, you can, you know, find something which makes you passionate about it. For me, it was working with influential people, you know, people who are very hard to reach out to, people who are very hard to close. And when I actually close them, it, you know, gives me a kick kind of thing. So that's how I be productive, that I like doing that. So yeah, that was the answer for you. You have to figure it out on your own, right? If you haven't even started, money can be the best motivator. Afterwards, you can find your own motivator, you know. So now I'll answer some questions on the voice chat. Feel free to unmute and ask.
Where is your motion graphic that you made for UserLeap?
UserLeap what?
You made a motion graphic, you said, for UserLeap on Product Hunt or something?
Yeah, so wait, let me just check the Product Hunt page. So Product Hunt.
Ron is in the meanwhile. Actually, I'm working on a SaaS company of my own myself, and they're going to launch on Product Hunt next month, I guess. So how can you help me?
Just wait a minute. I'll answer the previous question first. So if you go on Product Hunt and search UserLeap, like there's the name UserLeap, and on the left side, there is a motion graphic, right? Like some screen is rotating, and then at the end, there's their logo UserLeap and, you know, some animation or some kind of stuff. So I help them out with that. So yeah, that was the answer to the previous question. And then you asked, how can I help you if you're working for a SaaS company? I don't, you know, have actually, experience in SaaS.
For a Product Hunt launch. So we are going to launch on Product Hunt as well. Like, so since you have experience with the same, I asked in that context.
I didn't help them launch, you know, the product on product. It was already launched, but if you go on the Product Hunt page, there's a motion graphic showing up. Besides their name, so that was created by me. Like they launched and they emailed me in the early hours of US. I think it was 5 a.m. in the US, but in India it was, you know, just evening time or something. So help them out with that.
Got it. Got it. All right.
So
how to get
how to get stuck on your own decisions while taking a step, especially in the teenager age, 19 or 20?
So this is more of a motivational or advice kind of question. Can you elaborate a bit, because it was, you know, a very generic question.
What are the criteria does the client sees in you? Means when you haven't got any portfolio, like you are fresher. So what are the criteria you choose upon to select you to close that deal? Can you show some light towards that?
So the only thing a client cares about is good work, right? If, as I said, if you don't have a portfolio, like make something for them and send it to them for free. Even if they don't close, then you can, you know, include those free stuff which you send in your portfolio, and next time it can be easier for you, right? So work for them for free, and if they have a lot of trust issues, if they are scared that you will under deliver on what you are saying, work for them for free for a week, give them a 7-day free trial, give them a 14-day free trial. Initially there is no loss in doing that, because even if they don't convert, you then have those assets to add in your portfolio. So that would be my advice. So Webhav is asking,
they're not worried about your graduate or not, like they don't care about.
Oh, they don't care.
Even though a college guy, you can.
When I started, I was like 18 years old, right? And I have that everywhere, like all my socials and even, you know, from the email kind of picture which I have, it's very easy to make out that I'm very young. But because the work was good, they didn't even care. They didn't even ask me that, hey, do you get time, or like, you are young, do you get time on the side of college or something? They were just ready to go with it. And of course, you have to keep delivering, right? It's not just you have to deliver during the time of the sale. If you don't deliver after the sale, you are just going to get fired.
So where do you make your portfolio, and like how do you present it to your clients?
This is a repeated question, so I'll finally answer this. I have a portfolio on Dropbox, but I can't make it public because clients don't want everyone to have access to their files. So I have, you know, like, it's not like a perfect portfolio, like designs that, hey, this is my work or something. It's just files uploaded on Dropbox. But I have the permission to share with prospects. Like, let's say someone reaches out to me and says, hey, we would like to pay you for this, or can you show us some samples of your work? I can share maybe some links of the files, but not everything. So portfolio, I started with, you know, free work. I send them something for free, they converted, and then the portfolio just kept, you know, getting, like, it kept increasing. And I have, you know, that Dropbox Pro subscription, or if you deal with large files, I think Dropbox is perfect. Don't go for Google Drive, because Google Drive has problems with video playback. Dropbox has no problems with video playback. So I think just for 900 rupees per month, you can get like 2 terabytes of storage on Dropbox. So that would be a side piece of advice. Yeah.
What exactly the work do you do? Like, what service do you exactly offer to your clients?
Yeah, so search Gary Vee content model on Google, which is known as content repurposing. Go through that PDF. It's like 80 to 86 pages. That whole model takes a lot of time, takes a lot of efforts. So that is what I do for clients who want that service. I explained that in detail initially when I started this voice chat. So maybe if there's some recording available after we end this session, maybe you can check that out. But yeah, that will be the short answer. Now I'll pick a question from the text channel. Webhav is asking, so do the client easily trust the software, timesheet, Logify, etc., outcomes of your hourly billing? Some of them are manual. So timesheets is not a software, it's a concept. Basically, there are a lot of kind of, you know, websites and tools which let you build timesheets. Clockify is a software, but timesheets is just a concept, right? Timesheet is a PDF document which has, you know, daily data, like on 14 December you worked from this time to this time on this thing, and the entire thing for the month is known as a timesheet. So of course clients trust it, but they will only trust it if you provide them a breakdown. So along with the timesheet, I provide them a breakdown that, hey, the Instagram videos, you know, took this much, this thing took this much, this thing took this much. And if you inflate the hours to earn more, the clients will understand, right? Like, nobody's a fool. You might think that they don't know about your service, so you can amp up the hours. It doesn't work like that. It actually leaves a very bad impression. And so far, timesheets have been perfect for me. No trust issues or anything. And you can also, you know, use that. If your client wants you to use some other software, maybe you can use that. But I think timesheets work perfectly. You can use Clockify, but then, you know, you have to again start, stop. It's very irritating for me, so I use timesheets. So Ansh is asking, how did you attract target audience for your YouTube videos in your starting age? This is not really a freelancing question, so I would not, you know, spend a lot of time on this. I would maybe explain it in 30 to 40 seconds. So when I started my YouTube channel, I picked the topics which had high search volumes but low competition. There are a lot of YouTube extensions, which like Chrome extensions, which let you do that. There is TubeBuddy, there is vidIQ, there is a lot. So just, you know, Google or, you know, surf on the internet about how to use them. And then pick, you know, like high demand, low supply topics to kind of grow initially. And of course, you know, I've been out of the YouTube game for a while now because I've been all into freelancing. So I don't know the latest strategies, but that's what I did in the initial days. So that would be the short answer. Shashwat is asking, what leverage does registering a firm gives? It gives a lot of options. Basically, if you want to use Stripe, I think you need a current account. I'm not sure. You also need import export code, which is IEC. And, you know, like registering a firm, it's not some fancy thing, right? Registering a company can be a fancy thing, but registering a sole proprietorship, you can do it online in like, what, 10, 15 minutes. Of course, GST returns can be hard for you, so you can outsource that. I have actually outsourced it to a website called Vakil Search. You can hire your own CA. You can do whatever you want. For me, you know, Vakil Search works kind of cool. So it gives a lot of leverage. You can do, you know, transactions on the name of your business instead of your personal name. Other, you know, multiple options. And if you are getting, you know, a lot of, you know, volume of international transactions, current account will be a safer way to go. Otherwise, transactions can get flagged on savings accounts. So, yeah.
Hey.
Hello.
Hey, hello, Virat.
So you think that we should give a trial of 14 days or 7 days or something?
Hey, can you just mute yourself? I got your question. Just mute yourself.
No, that's not my question, actually. You said that you could give trial for 7 days or 14 days. Mm-hmm. But you also said that that it takes almost two to three years. So what, when I do that, the problem comes is when I do that work from 1 month, clients always start saying that we are not getting results.
See, you have to get that, you know, get that point across on the first Zoom meeting itself, right? That this thing, like what are the results of a brand, right? Branding is always long term. The only short term thing is sales. So you have to explain them that on the first Zoom meeting itself, that, and this is the one other point which has helped me throughout, you know, this freelancing thing. If someone is not getting convinced, just leave them, just go to the next prospect. You don't have to spend your entire time on convincing someone who is unconvincible. Maybe they are just, you know, too rigid. Maybe, like, of course, you give some efforts. Don't be like, you know, if they throw one objection and you're like, okay, I don't want to work with you. You know, do the right thing, give your efforts. But if they just don't get the value of a personal brand in today's age, just, you know, be like, okay, just let's part ways or something like that and go to the next prospect. Don't spend too much of time on a prospect who you intuitively know will not be able to close. So yeah.
So what does the question they ask in the Zoom meeting, the clients?
It's very simple. So Zoom meeting, mostly it's just to, you know, get to know the other person and make sure that the person is legit. I mean, anyone can email, but on Zoom meeting, you know, you really show your cards, you know, they get to know you. And because it's not possible to meet them in person, of course, if you are living in India and they are in US, you can meet them in person. So Zoom meeting kind of builds a good bond. They know that, yes, you are legit. And they ask, you know, very simple and simple questions. Like, okay, this is how my schedule look like, and this is what I want to get done from you. How will it work? What will be the workflow? How much time do I need to spend? And some things. And as I said in the beginning of the session, if you are trying to genuinely be helpful, you will like breeze through the Zoom meeting. It's not very hard. Just don't be very salesy. Don't act like a salesman doing all the tricks and stuff on them. everyone gets it. Everyone knows when they are being sold and when they are being helped. So know the difference.
Hey, at starting, you say that you made a list of 10 people or 10 prospects. So where did you exactly get the 10 prospects? Or in LinkedIn, what exactly did you search or like that? What's the exact?
Sure. So in my case, you know, the main kind of industry term for content repurposing is, you know, there are like 2 to 3 phases. There's the Gary V content model, there's content repurposing, there is micro content. So I used to search all these terms on LinkedIn and Twitter. And that was, you know, kind of the social listening method to find clients. That's how I found my first client, you know, which I closed in March. I'll explain the whole story. And then most of the prospecting is just, you know, me coming across different people on LinkedIn. Like, let's say if I go on LinkedIn and scroll for 10 minutes, I'm going to find a lot of people, you know, who are trying to put, let's say if they posted something on LinkedIn, I go to their profile and I see they haven't posted for the past 1 month. They just posted today. And I see that they are, you know, running a business and they're also following Gary Vee. That those things give me the pointers that, yes, this can be someone, you know, who I should reach out to. So as I said, prospecting is different for everyone. But for me, I use LinkedIn and Twitter social listening. I found, you know, that prospect which I talked about, running an IT services company in Washington, D.C., not able to find time for content. Actually, they started a podcast, but, you know, they weren't able to repurpose the content for all platforms. So I helped them with that. And that's, the rest is just history.
Hey, Ronit, you told that you wanted to work with big companies, right? So you could have done that in any other way. So how did you finally come to a conclusion that you want to do that? What have you told?
Initially, it's hard to work with big companies, right? Your first client can be a big client. I mean, it can be in some cases, but first you have to really build the proof of work that you are legit. Once you have a good portfolio, it gets easier. And once you actually work with a big company, it's easier to work with other big companies because they will refer you to other, you know, people. And that's pretty much it. And most of the things happen over emails, right? A lot of people think that when I work with these clients, it's just some fancy thing. It's nothing fancy. Most of the stuff happens over email and sometimes Zoom meetings. And trust me, I have, you know, seen this shift. People are increasingly, you know, becoming comfortable with just text. They just want to do WhatsApp, emails and stuff like that. And they don't want to do meetings. And all of us are like that, right? None of us want to get on meetings again and again. Text is very comfortable. You can lay in your bed and do emails and stuff. So that's how it kind of happens. You can't get started with, you know, like suddenly you can't work with big clients. You have to slowly build that. And once you have a big portfolio, you yourself will also be comfortable to charge a higher price. And that's how it kind of goes.
So I have seen this kind of thing with Indian clients that they want something much more than what they pay actually. I'm selling the services like video editing. They later on, at some point of time, they also want to edit something, apart from that, and extra effort. So does the same thing happens with the foreign clients as well?
Not really. I mean, if you're working, as I said, if you're working with a credible person, they are very professional with this thing, right? This is what you will be delivering and this is what you will be charging. It's not like after you deliver, they are like, okay, can you do this something extra for me as well? Of course, if you know it's your first client, you can do it for them just to kind of build a good relationship. But no, they are not very extra demanding, you know. They'll just, once you do it, do the work, you send the invoice, they'll get you paid and stuff. It's very, very professional. Depends on how kind of you know, the quality of clients you deal with. And it's very easy to judge the credibility of someone through their LinkedIn profile. So I'll pick a question from the text channel. What is the work that you do? Already explained. Maybe watch the recording afterwards. How did you attract target? Okay, I answered this. How you estimate time? Like, is work mitna time? Like, I don't estimate. I track time. As I said, timesheets or time tracking software helps you track time. Basically, you start doing work, you know, it's tracking in the background, or after you have some experience, let's say you are working for like 1 or 2 months, then it's just very easy to kind of, you know that, okay, this is going to take me this much, that is going to take me that much. So the other question is, where can we see your work? I already explained this. How do you deal with low ballers? What do you really mean by low ballers? Like clients who try to put you down or don't want to pay that much or what? Let me know in the text channel. Do you